it's a pleasure to speak here today. So my lab utilizes X-ray crystallography and protein biochemistry to chiefly tackle problems that are microbiological in nature. And I've been slightly cheeky and leading today with my title, in that it's what can we learn from structural biology studies of predatory bacteria. So I want that to kind of be a message to you as to how I'm directing this initial part of what my lab does. And then hopefully in 20 years, I'll give a talk entitled What We Did Learn from the Structural Studies of Predatory Bacteria. And I can only hope it fills longer than 10 minutes, I think. So if I was to ask you about what eats bacteria or what kills bacteria, you might first think of bacteriophage, or some of you may think of grazing amoeba, but I would imagine that most of you wouldn't think about other bacteria. But there's this whole world out there, and we can classify them into the four different types of predation you see behind me. And I would argue that they're all fairly undercharacterized and underrepresented in the scientific literature. So on the left-hand side, we have the myxococci, and they practice what we call wolf pack predation. So they're a wonderful model system for bacterial multicellularity, and they swarm around their prey, and then they get a bit less civilized, and they excrete antibiotics and hydrolytic enzymes, and then they kill their prey. And then in the middle here, we have two strains that are completely undercharacterized. There's one paper on each. The first is the wonderfully named Vampyrococcus. And this is an epibiotic predator, and it attaches to the outside of the prey, and as the name implies, sucks the life out of it. And then the next, even more brutish, directly invasive Daptobacter, does away with any subtlety whatsoever and completely pierces the prey, releasing its contents into the external environment. And then the bacteria I like to study, Delavibrio on the right-hand side, is a periplasmic predator. So it kills the prey from within, which is a wonderfully phenotypically rich system. And I have the benefit of an excellent collaborator, Professor Liz Sockett at Nottingham. And the point being here is that Delavibrio is not E. coli. It's very hard to culture, it's very difficult to perform genetics on. And so I collaborate with Liz on this aspect of handling the predator. And what I can tell you is the prey range is such that Delavibrio kills a large proportion of gram-negatives. And of course, these can be pathogens of man, crops, animals, and it kills them from within, so it lives in their periplasm. It has a 3.5 megabase unusual genome. So it's not reductive evolution. This is not a parasite. This is a true predator. And it's an unusual genome in that a third of its gene products have no homology to anything. And I'll come back to that at the end of the talk. It's found in soil. It's found in water. It's found in the digestive tract of us and of animals. And what you see is it starts off in a free-living phase. It swims. It finds its prey. And it's a very fast swimmer because it's a very small cell. It attaches to prey, and then a recognition event occurs, and it cuts a hole in the outer membrane, and it pulls itself into the periplasm, and then it seals itself inside. It changes the shape of the prey from rod shape to round, which I'll come back to again in a minute, and then it has this very unusual growth where it makes a super long cell, and then it divides into progeny all at once. And what that allows it to do is make anywhere from 3 to 11 progeny and not waste any of the resources at its disposal. And then the cycle begins again. And the reason why I study it, which is coming quite late into the talk, but the reason why I study this organism is it should be an excellent tutor of antibacterial activity. It should be a wonderful tutor of bacterial physiology. And in terms of synthetic biology, you couldn't wish for a more diverse set of enzymes of high activity. So those are the research strengths of Delavibrio. And one of the first questions that my collaboration with Liz looked into is, how is the host manipulated? So it's a very phenotypically rich system, and you're observing this. And even in the early days of Delavibrio research, back in the late 60s, early 70s, you could see that the prey shape, the shape of the prey cell is rod-shaped. And as soon as Delavibrio gets inside and invades, a shape change occurs. And if you will, it pops the prey cell into a sphere shape. And for decades, the conventional dogma was that this was done to give room for the predator to grow within. Okay, so you can ask how this occurs, and with a knowledge of bacteriology, you would say, well, what's going on here, we suspect, is Delavibrio is metabolizing the prey cell wall, and that's causing a shape change where the rod shape just collapses into a sphere. And a very talented PhD student, Tom Lerner, had a hypothesis that these two genes of Delavibrio, BD3459, BDO816, were responsible. So these genes share 60% identity, they're very similar, and they have a low homology to other peptidoglycan hydrolases that are present in all bacteria. So Tom made a double knockout, and it's wonderful. You see on the right-hand side that Delavibrio has got inside, but the prey is still rod-shaped because you've knocked out the shape conversion enzymes. And what was seen from that was something totally unexpected. When you do not catalyze the change to round, you get superinfection. So the prey is still rod-shaped and it's still prime for invasion. So a second Delavibrio will enter, and then a third. And this is, as you would imagine, to relate it to population fitness. So the reason why it catalyzes that shape change is to tell its kin, go away, I'm making the most of eating this cell. So it's a population fitness effect. And as a structural biologist, for me, there's a fascinating question here. How does predation as a lifestyle evolve? So presumably way back in time, the progenitor to Delavibrio was non-predatory. And then it had to turn a set of genes into products it could now use to become a predator and to kill other bacteria. So what we have in the bottom here is a regular peptidoglycan hydrolase from all bacteria. This is E. coli PBP4. And the job of this is to snip the wall so that the biosynthetic machinery can come in, produce more wall material into the gap, and the cell elongates. So this is an enzyme involved in growth, and it has to be very tightly regulated. And what Delavibrio has done is it's taken this housekeeping gene and turned it into an agent of killing. So what you see here is this regulatory domain of PBP4, it is over the active site, and it attenuates the activity of PBP4. So it stops it from being an incredibly active enzyme, which would just chew up the wall and the cell would die. But this is what Delavibrio wants. So it's taken that regulatory 3 domain off there in orange, and it's replaced it with a completely different domain. And this is the active site here, and what Delavibrio done in purple is add an extension on that to make it a better enzyme. And so what we can say is it's taken a housekeeping enzyme and used it for predation purposes. Now, this slide to me, and what I want to communicate to you, represents me being a child in a toy shop. So we take all the stages of predation, and I say as my lab, what am I going to work on? So I love alliteration, so these are the 7 R's, and in chronology of the life cycle, we start off with a recognition and a regulation event. You meet prey, you have to realize that you've done this, and you have to kickstart killing. And what does this is the ubiquitous second messenger cyclic diGMP. So this is a small cyclic RNA of 2 nucleotides, and it's used by most bacteria to regulate their motility or their ability to produce a biofilm. But rather wonderfully in Delavibrio, it's used to start killing and control the killing events. And this is a very difficult area to work in because you've got 5 enzymes that make it, 6 enzymes that break this signaling agent, and you have 20 proteins that receive the signal and then catalyze downstream effects. So we're starting with a few of these, and one of these you can see here has a domain on the bottom that senses a cellular metabolite, and the domain then at the top, a conformational change occurs and it turns on an enzyme that metabolizes cyclic DIGMP. So what we're linking here is the hunger of Delavibrio to the killing events. And then secondly, we have a rupture event where it breaks through that outer membrane. And there's a protein we're working on in our lab here that protects Delavibrio during this hydrolytic onslaught. Because this is an organism that's making an incredible amount of proteases, nucleases, and it has to protect its own material while it performs this predatory lifestyle. The third point there, ratchet, is a wonderful process where Delavibrio uses type 4 pili as a molecular grappling hook. It projects them through the hole it's made in the outer membrane. They find something and then it pulls itself in. So what we would like to do in my lab is look at what targets those pili are binding to. And then we have the reseal event in point 4, which is quite incredible. It's cut a hole in the outer membrane, but it now has biosynthetic ability to plug that gap. So that would be a rather interesting enzyme indeed. And then for my alliteration to work, we have run amok, at which point it goes crazy and metabolizes the prey cell. And this is a protein we're working on in my lab that is secreted into the host cell and chemically modifies it so that Delavibrio can tell what material comes from its prey and what material comes from itself, which is a rather interesting point indeed. And the last stage is reproduce, which is rather unique because you have that single long filament that doesn't undergo binary fission. So how on earth you regulate nucleoid reproduction is just, would be a wonderful thing to study, a completely different way of reproducing. The eighth R, to my eyes, is the return to a pre-informatics age. So if a third of your genome doesn't look like anything else, it's almost like being in a time machine where we know way less about biochemistry. So you've got 3,700 genes to choose from, and your choice of study is going to be influenced by the existing literature, where you look at arrays, you look at qPCR, you look at RNA-seq, and you narrow down the genes important for predation. And if you do this, for example, you can say from arrays, which is the protein that's most upregulated as I'm entering prey? And you'll find this, and it's a gene that's 10,000-fold upregulated upon entry. And you say, okay, I'm going to put it into blast. And as you see, you get one hit, which is, of course, the thing you're looking for, that you've searched with, and it tells you nothing. You're in a land with no sequence alignments, no functional annotation. So this is where structural biology can play a really big role. So I mean, you might accuse me of phishing, but what I say I'm going to do is I'm going to solve the structure, and let's pick up some clues from this. So here we go. Some crystals. If you're familiar with the children's character Mr. Tickle, this is our nickname for this particular protein. So remember, it's the most populous protein as this invasion begins. And what we see is the protein is on a signal peptide, so presumably secreted. We've removed that from our crystallization construct. It's got a really small body, and then it moves up into this huge one arm up the left that's disulfide bonded at the elbow. It comes back, goes into this slightly smaller arm on the right that is again disulfide bonded, comes back to this small fold, and finishes with another disulfide bond. And you can ask the question, you can say, okay, so Mr. Tickle didn't have any genetic relatives. Okay, does it now have any structure relatives? And this is the first time I've ever seen this in my career. You put this into a server that says, does this structure look like other servers? And you don't even get noise. So as you can see from this is a really bizarre protein structure. So now What we're doing is looking for functional clues from this. And like I said, it's like a molecular time machine. And you go back, and what you find is that Mr. Tickle likes to make higher order oligomers. And when it does, it makes a ring. And when you change the pH, that ring flexes and closes. Now, that's precisely where we are with this project. And I really think that in an organism that harbors 1,200 unrelated genes, we're going to see a little more craziness like this. And I'm going to have to really get my thinking cap on to push the functional characterization of these predation proteins forward. So in terms of acknowledgements, my collaborator at Nottingham, Liz Sockett, is an absolutely wonderful scientist. And she works on the genetics and microscopy characterization of this organism. UBC Vancouver, where I came from, my previous supervisor, Natalie Stranica, was very generous in allowing me to kickstart this project whilst present in her lab. My postdoc, Ian, is an absolutely wonderful scientist, and he's progressing with studying the wall metabolism of prey. And then the Birmingham biophysics community and Gerd Prehner in Chicago, who is tackling the NMR on some intrinsically disordered proteins of Delavibrio, which, fair play to him, it will be a quite difficult thing to do, I think. And thanks to these bodies for funding and the University of Birmingham with its rather wonderful red brick campus. Thank you.